thank you very much. So I will start with my presentation. The title is The Power of Improvisation. So I'm working at the St. Pölten University of Applied Sciences in the fields of higher didactics. I'm also teaching there and I'm working in the areas of research there. I'm also a freelancing teacher and counselor and trainer and improviser. Let's have a look at the history of improvisation methods. So the methods I will be going to talk today, they have their origins on the beginning of the early cultures of the world and go back to the first steps of people who had the role as shaman or trickster or clowns, and they used aspects of improvisation in their work. Also, there are traces and traces of improvisation methods in the ancient world and in the Middle Ages and in the threshold to the modern era. What I'm going to tell you today is mostly originated in the work happening since the 20th century, where Neva Boyd and Viola Spolin collected different methods and games and adapted them to use them in very various settings, especially in teaching. And one aspect of their work is to raise the self-efficacy of people, helping to raise their voice and helping them in their learning journeys and helping them generally to speak out loud. So there are also the methods also have their origins on the work that Augusto Boal took and in the approaches of drama and education. And if you look at it, you can find a lot of methods I will talk today about under the umbrella term of applied theater. So it's about using improvisational approaches and theatrical methods in different areas, and here in the area of higher education. So let's take a look on the various methods of applied improvisation, and they all are also can be done in an online setting. That has been also part of my thesis I finished about one half a year about, where I worked with researchers from all around the world and using methods of applied improvisation also in online sessions. So there are six fields we are going to look today. There are warm-up methods, the approach about walk around the room, body images, mirroring and copying, methods of association by words or using the body, and scenic work. And I will give you now an overview and an impression on the different methods. So let's start with the warm-up methods. Here's one classical warm-up game which is used in many settings. So it's about these methods. They help to get the people into focus, and you can do these methods in all settings, also in a setting of a lecture hall, because people always can stand up and move together in as a turn around and look at each other. And it's about getting to know each other. It's about taking in the reactions of others. And there are lots of different methods of warm-up methods to get used to these approaches and methods. I'm going to talk afterwards about the framework, how to use these methods in didactic settings. And one aspect I want to emphasize at this point is they shouldn't be the exception, but it should be like a red thread through the whole teaching, where you over and over again use this method in a special way. So let's take a look and other methods. One very important method is walking around the room. So it's basically people walking around the room in different energies and different status and on different ideas. And it's about connecting our brain with our heart, with our feet. And here's one variation of walking through the room. I've been using this method, for instance, in a lecture for dietitians who use this approach as a method to learn something about how to meet people they are treating and how they could make the first introduction and how could they help them to find their own solutions for the health problems. So it's a very good way of using the concept of walk through the room, which is in this method, a method from Auguste Boal. You can also use it in a cramped space where there's no place to move around, because you can also do it if you're standing. And you can do it in online rooms using your fingers in different ways. So this is walking around the room. The next method is body images. So using different body images to tell stories, to give insights in concepts like mathematics, like statistics, like coding, like engineering. It can also be used as an aspect of body storming in any kind of design thinking area and in any study which is about finding solutions for everyday problems, which is body images. Also something that origins from the work mostly from Auguste Boal. The next very important method is that one of copying and mirroring. So that's a very impressive way of doing it here, conducted by Mr. Schwarz, who is an important person who to make it sure that the methods and approaches of Viola Spolin get in every thinkable area of work, like consulting, like teaching. And it's mirroring and copying is about taking in the ideas and the feelings of other persons and reacting to them and to build upon it. So applied improvisation is a lot about being aware of each of some of the resources some people have their own and of the resources from somebody else and from the ideas other people bring in into learning situations. So this is mirroring and copying. Another method are games like this. So these people pretend to using balls in different shapes and colors and passing around them in the room. And afterward, this principle is introduced. You think about a topic you are teaching, for instance, project management, and you talk about what size is this ball and what it's, is it its structure and what is how can you, is it hot or cold? And if you pass it around, what sounds that it make? And there are different balls around, and then you talk about different aspects, for instance, as project management, and talking on them, how can they feel them? How can you make them working? How could it happen that you fail? So it's about failure management. It's about planning, it's about brainstorming, and so on. So these are methods of association, working with words, working with body images, and working with sounds and words. So here's another example of an association game. So this method is also working faster than shown here, but it's a method of collaborating on ideas, on concepts, on thinking about solutions to difficult questions, like working on solutions on math problems which are text-based. I've used these methods, for instance, in my studies from my thesis with Mr. Christian Spannagel, working with students learning math in a higher institution of higher education, and it works very well. So people find new solutions to difficult problems, and they have the power to bring in more ideas and more creativity, a key competency that's asked by most of the areas you can work, and of course it's a key competency for our world we are living in. So what I want to emphasize is there are loads of literature which look upon the effect methods and effects of applied improvisation method in different settings, and I will later on give the link of my presentation in the chat so you can look on this literature, and it's only and first insight in it. So what are steps to applied improvisational methods as didactic interventions? The first and most important thing is a good didactic design, which is also competency orientated. So it's looking on the lecture and seeing it as a whole story that is told together with the students. And it not only starts in the first date when you meet them, but it starts, of course, with informations students get before they meet in an e-learning system. You will need for any kind of innovative teaching, you need a learning management system where students can find various materials from audio to text to use cases and so on. And they can find also tasks that are connected to these materials, and they find then overview what will happen in online in meeting together, and teachers have to think what methods will they use to help the students to build upon a self-learning self-learning steps where they work alone or in small groups. And they will also not only think about methods used in online set in physics settings, but also in the self-paced learning. And of course, one aspect is helping students to reflect, am I on the right way of my study? Am I on the right way of developing my competency as a man or woman or anything you want to be? And so assessment have the task to help students to reflect if they are on the right way. And improvisational methods are part of this didactic design. So it's not about going out and saying, oh, tomorrow I will use that wonderful method of Red Bull and see what is happening. And if they don't like it, I will change it and do something different. But it's you're thinking about the learning outcomes that are also part of the didactic design. And you're choosing one specific method and are you adapting for this very learning step. So this method in the didactic design can be used in solo settings where people work alone, or in small groups, in self-paced and self-organized learning times, and also in meetings that are held together at the university or in hybrid or in online settings. So it's always a part of a didactic design, which is combined with other methods and other steps, and not only just a nice idea which you pull out of thin air. Because improvisation is, of course, using the power of thinking on your feet and acting in the here and now. And it's also a lot about preparation, and also a lot about of use of choosing very methods. You think about why I use this method, what is the aim, how can I help the students to move on in their learnings. So the first part, the first step of using this method is making a good didactic design and implementing. A step that could be important before that is that you read about these methods, that you try them out together with other teachers or in your free time. But it's everybody listening now to this speech can use methods of applied improvisation, and it's one of the methods you can choose in as a variation of a didactic intervention. So the second thing is to introduce the rules of improvisation. I know that maybe it sounds a bit funny because improvisation and rules, but there are some rules. And these are the following. The first rule is you can't do anything wrong. So you will make some failures and you will stumble and anything else, but you can't do anything wrong. And that's the one rule. Another rule is embrace your first idea. Don't think too hard and use the very first idea that comes to your mind and speak it out loudly or show it in your body or in your language. That's the second very important rule. Another rule is be part of the process. Bring in yourself. Don't stand or sit at the margin and just look. So jump in and bring in yourself. Another mantra is let your partner shine. So help other people find their ideas, set them into action, and help them to be the best. The best variation of themselves and evolve themselves. And the mantra of applied improvisation is the rule of yes and. So it's about what you are saying to me or what are you showing to me or what are you writing. I'm looking at it and I say to you what I like about your idea. So looking on these rules of improvisation, you of course recognize they are also helpful for being a good dialogue-orientated teacher and for the whole learning process. And they are very important to use them as a part of the concept of a safe space where everybody feels well to use methods that are not so common and speak out loudly and to move around and so. And I've worked with a lot of people and there's a whole load of literature that improvisational methods have been used in all areas. You can think about working with leaders, working with people who are not employed for a long time and so on and so on. And the studies show very clearly that people are ready to use this method in a very playful way and use them as a learning process and use them as a way to evolve their self-efficiency. Then, as said before, one important aspect is to use warm-up methods like SIP-SAP-SPOINC or other methods to help the people to get to know these methods, and also they are a way to help people to get to know each other, which is important, not only at the beginning of learning of lectures, but as a concept used through the whole study. And these warm-ups also help to let go your ways of thinking too hard and to embrace your first idea and also to have the courage to speak out, to jump out and to do things. So warm-ups are another very important part of the didactic design you have to think about when you're using improvisational methods. Another one which is very intense connected to the didactic design are instructions for action. So this one instruction for action could be take a sheet of paper and write down at least 10 ideas you can think about using improvisational methods. And of course, you're doing that right now. And don't think too hard because the pencil you have in hand is taking over to you and you write down the 10 first ideas that come to your mind. So instruction for action is telling the people what is the method about? So it could be the focus on project management. It could be about exploring a mathematical approach. It could be approaching a coding problem. It could be looking on the relationships to patients and so on. So this instruction for action is shaping the method, and these instructions for action, they are they can also be brought in by the students themselves. So firstly, you use as a teacher use instructions for actions, and afterwards students use them, and that's the way that everyday problems and challenges of daily life, of work-related problems, or about problems about sustainable development goals come into these methods. And it's also one aspect why these methods and approaches are in a very intense way helping people to participate, so be part of the the working together, not only listen to what the teacher is doing, but also bring on their own ideas, own problems, own solutions, own hopes and fears. So these instructions for action have their origin on the didactical design and also come from students, as said before. One other important aspect is side coaching. So you remind people while they during they are using this improvisational methods not to embrace the first ideas, to use the third thing that comes to their mind, and to think about the instructions and to move on in the method. So one aspect of improvisational methods is using a very limited time, so people don't have the chance to think too hard, and they using the concept of thinking on your feet, and side coaching keeps the methods running. And side coaching is also an aspect that students can take, especially if you're working with larger groups. You can use improvisational methods with any size of groups because you can do any method in a circle or in a group of 2 to 7 or 8 people, and then you give the students in this circle the task of taking over the side coaching, and also of bringing in instructions for the next methods. So side coaching is also a way of making happen that methods of applied improvisation also can be used in larger groups. So, and one very, very, very important point about using applied improvisation methods, and by the way, for any method you use in a lecture, is debriefing. So after you use the method, you have planned some time, that could also be in the self-organized time of a lecture, where you talk what has happened in this method. So there are typical questions what did you recognize using this method? What connections did you find to the topic we are just working about in? What ideas did you find working together? How could you use this approach or this method or this mindset in other settings? So this debriefing is a very, very important aspect of making the transfer of what happened in the improvisational methods into daily life, into the learning process, into changing this planet for good. So debriefing sums up the everything that happens, and as said before, it should happen in any case of any method you use in a lecture. So I'm at the end of my input, and once again I'm I'm very thankful that I've been part of this conference, and I hope that you are inspired, and I hope that you have the courage to use this method. I will put into the chat room the link to my presentation. And if you have any questions about using applied improvisation, please make sure to make contact with you. I will help you to use it in your lecture. Thank you very much.